Marianne, we could start with some biographical details. Like, you started as an 18-year-old innocent girl thrown into the
17.
Music business.
17.
Yes. So you met Andrew Luke Oldham and you recorded As Tears Go By. How did that go?
I met Andrew at a party in 1964. And I don't know how I came to be at this party, but there were lots of sort of people from Sween, London there. Mick Jagger, Keith Richard, Chrissy Shrimpton, Paul McCartney, Jane Asher, Peter and Gordon, all these people. And me, with my boyfriend at the time, John Dunbar, who I later married. And Andrew Oldham asked John Dunbar if I could sing. And he said he thought I could, and would I like to make a record? And that's how I came to make As Tears Go By.
You also started in the theatre and the movies at the same period.
Let's speak about the theatre. I started acting... when I decided to stop recording. '66, I decided to stop making records.
Why was it so?
Partly because by then I was living with Mr. Jagger and I didn't want to be in competition. I couldn't. Mm. So I decided to do something else, and I'd always wanted to act.
In theatre, you played in Hamlet and also The Three Sisters of Chekhov.
I was very lucky. And with very good people. In The Three Sisters, Glenda Jackson played Marcia. In Hamlet, Nicole Williamson played Hamlet. Anthony Hopkins was Claudius, the king. Yes, those were the two things I did that I'm proud of.
As far as movies are concerned, you played in a movie called Girl on a Motorcycle, La Fille à la Motocyclette, with Alain Delon.
Yes.
It's sort of popular over Europe.
Yes. I personally think it looks like an advertisement for Harley-Davidson motorbikes. I don't like it. Yeah, the theatre is a very snobby world. And the whole thing is you have to be very dedicated. And I certainly wasn't that dedicated at that time. You really, it seems to me, you have to have wanted to be a film star since you were tiny, which was not one of my ambitions. Now, I look at it differently. If the theatre is 19th century, the 20th century is very much sound and vision together. And I'm very interested in video.
After some time, between 69 and 76, you did nothing.
Almost. Yes, I stopped completely. I'd been working very hard since I was 17. And I really wanted to live. I wanted to do things that I wanted to do and not be responsible to the public or to anybody. I felt I'd been living in a goldfish bowl, and I'd had enough. There's nothing I can say that will affect the drug problem, and it is a very great problem, I realise this. But what I say, or do even, affects it neither one way nor the other. Somehow I don't feel that my remarks or actions are that important, and I never give advice.
Do you mind having this this public image of the Sister Morphine song and everything? Because it's part of your image.
Yes, it is. As it is part of me, if I was to mind about it, I would be stupid. It's just part of it. It's not part of my image, it's just part of my life. Therefore, I accept it.
Mm-hmm. The first step in your comeback was in 76 with an LP called Faithless, which wasn't a success.
It wasn't a very good record.
No.
No. But for me, it was a very useful way of getting back into what's called the music business. It meant I could go back in sideways without too much pressure. If there'd been an enormous amount of pressure with a big record company to make a great record, at that time I couldn't have done it.
But you could 2 years later with a broken English. 3 years later, I'm sorry, with a broken English.
By then I was ready to do it, yes. It's about Ulrike Meinhof. It's just an observation on her life. At the time, she was in the Red Army faction in Germany. At that time, I was taking heroin. And what interested me was that the two things were very connected. They're both very destructive. But I am alive, she's dead. I felt that somehow, at the early 70s, I could have gone the same way as she did.
Broken English, as an LP, was more or less sort of a statement on the world, because it was very hard songs about society. Was that conscious or an accident?
It was simply my view, the world seen from my point of view. It wasn't a conscious statement on the world. I knew it was good, but broken English, even broken English is very personal. The songs, the covers I did, simply happened to be songs that I believed myself. They, like Working Class Hero, Ballad of Lucy Jordan, Why'd You Do It, were written by other people. But I felt I could have written them myself.
There was quite a long gap between Broken English and Dangerous Acquaintances. Why was it so long?
Well, it takes as long as it takes. A record of mine, a Marianne Faithfull record, is not like toast. It's not going to pop up every 3 months. To write the songs, things have to happen first. It just takes a long time. The next record will be another 2 years, I'm sure.